Not by might, not by power, by your spirit, God. Send your spirit,
thank the Lord for just being God Almighty. And today we want to move forward as the Lord continues to inspire us through His Word. That's so important. And right now it's feeding time. And this morning we have a special message that I believe that God has for us, and also one of our very own. Amen. Elder James Byrd is going to be bringing the word this morning, and I just want to introduce him, a faithful husband, a man that loves God and loves people. And I know that there are many accolades that I could express, but I just believe that his heart is to express the love of Jesus, and that's what he's content with. Amen. The Bible tells us that godliness with contentment is great gain. And so I introduce to you our dear brother, amen, and share with you, those who know him, amen, Elder James Byrd. God bless you, my brother. Bless you.
Good morning, good morning. Can you hear me this morning? Look up, beep your horns if you can hear me. Amen, amen. It's wonderful to be before you again this morning, and I must say that it's simply by God's grace and mercy that we are here. To those that are listening at home, via streaming live, and those at radio, and those the body of Christ that are here this morning. As the pastor said, is that my love is for the Lord, and oftentimes people will say that, but it's in their actions and their deeds that demonstrate just, in fact, how much they do love the Lord. This morning, before we begin, let us bow in a word of prayer. Most precious and gracious Father, I thank you for the grace and mercy that you bestowed upon us this morning, without which none of us could be here, sitting in our vehicles or sitting at home, sipping coffee and watching, Heavenly Father. But there's a underlying reasons why we are sitting in cars and sitting at home, because there's a message that you're sending to your people. And Father, this morning I'd like to just expose that word just a little bit more to help them understand that there are things that we must be certain about in our lives, and that we have focused and we have set our hearts and minds on those things that are eternal. In order to do that, it must be the proclamation of Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. So we thank you this morning. We pray for the church. We pray for the community. We pray for the state. We pray for our nation in these very distressing times. So Father, we thank you, and we most certainly give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. For it is in Christ Jesus' name we pray, and we said amen. Bump your horns if you said amen. Hallelujah. This morning I want to talk to you about something that we have oftentimes procrastinated about, and we delay it until things like this COVID, which has been talked about for the past 5 or 6 months, and people are finding it very difficult to make up their minds. And I preached on this a while back about it's time to make up your mind, and today the message continues on about some folks still have not made up their minds. And we turn to your Bibles in Joshua chapter 24, if you would. Joshua chapter 24. I'm going to read the text, and the key verse in this message is found in verse 14. There were exciting times for the people of Israel. They had defeated their enemies and claimed the promised land, and each of the tribes had received their inheritance, and now they could settle down and enjoy life a little. It was time for hope and prosperity. And in America, we had made that claim many, many years ago, but there's something that's, because of this COVID-19, has brought us to a point that there are three things that we're faced with. Those things that we're going to have to, because we're living in times when it's challenging our faith, we contemplate what's our attitude towards our neighbor. There are confrontations about how we're going to live with our neighbor. And then the final is, are we really consecrated to come before our Lord and Savior? It was also a very dangerous time for those people, just as it is for the people today. And folk are having a very difficult time in understanding what's going on. After we've settled in and we're enjoying the prosperity of our lives here in America and the things that's going on, some people still find it difficult in recognizing that Jesus Christ is the Lord and Savior. But God is doing something to let us know, to stir our minds, to make us get into some thinking about what are we doing, to contemplate. Where's my life right now? What am I doing? And in the midst of all this, with Joshua had with the Israelites, here we are today trying to ask these questions. We are contemplating our place before the Lord, and we're examining ourselves, and we are being confronted with all types of issues in our lives, and we're wondering if we are truly consecrated in the Lord. We have to ask that question. In the midst of the situation that Joshua stood up to deliver to the people a challenge from the Lord, God wanted them to dedicate themselves to him and to his work. And he does not want them trying to live for him on one hand, on God, on the Canaan, on the other hand. He wanted wholehearted dedication to nothing. What we're living in right now, this pandemic is challenging us to recognize where we are and who are we going to serve. It's not a political thing. It's a spiritual thing. Politics has nothing to do with this. It's being said day in and day out. Politics has no place with this. Joshua said, I just want to remind you that these are dangerous times for the church as well. We are seeing a church develop an appearance that is more and more like the church of the Laodicea in Revelation 3:14. See, Laodicea was the wealthiest of the seven cities, where each of these seven churches were located for its banking industry and its medical schools. But it had lost its spiritual zeal for Christ. The church had become bland and this tepid water that flowed into the city. The people's attitude today in America, we're going to talk about America, not about the world right now, has grown tepid. And crises come in their lives. They begin to question God and question their faith, just as the Israelites did. After the times in their lives when things was just perfect for them, it was just everything was comfortable, and all of a sudden, here comes the turmoil, the crises in their lives. Believers did not take a stand for anything. The church had everything it needed except the presence and power and the glory of God. And you ask yourself today, is the presence and the power and glory of God in America today? It seems like it's missing. It didn't show up. It hasn't shown up for a while, as a matter of fact. And people are struggling and asking the questions, is God getting nearer? Indeed, he is. He's nearer today than he was 2,000 years ago. The point of that is that you need to have yourself ready for him no matter when he returns. message is, it's time to make up your mind, but I made the subject this morning. Some people are still having trouble making up their mind to whom they want to serve. In Joshua chapter 24, verse 14, it reads, "Now therefore fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in truth. And put away the gods which your fathers served on the other side of the river and in Egypt. Serve the Lord." Verse 15. "And if it seems evil to you to serve the Lord, choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." This is a very familiar passage of scripture. So the people answered and said, "Far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods." When we look around America today, we live in a very secular human society, and people have strayed away from that. They said, just as the Israelites said then, that far be it from us, we're not going to serve other gods. But it seems apparent today that wherever you turn, the Christian side of this, they're in ambiguity. They're not certain about whom they want to serve. And through this crisis that we are experiencing right now, it's causing a lot of believers, a lot of Christians, to question their faith, to whom they want to serve. You see it on television every day. What saddens me is that there's an element in our Christian community who will not stand up and defend the truth. If ever there was a time that Christians should be standing up defending the truth, all over America, now is the time. We make decisions not based on political ideologies, but on the biblical truth. Take this morning to look at these verses and hear the call of God giving us this morning. I want to preach for a few minutes. As I said a moment ago, people are still not sure about making up their minds, still having trouble making up their minds. They don't know whether they want to go for Christ or go for the political party. But I tell you this, the day of judgment, when you stand before the Father, he's not going to ask you which party group, political group, were you affiliated with. That's not going to be the question, no. He's going to ask the question, whom did you put your faith and trust in? Who was the one that brought you every day of your life? A time in contemplation. Joshua begins his remarks by calling them to the time of contemplation. He wants them to remember who they are and where they came from. You need to remember where God has brought you from. Just as Joshua reminded the Israelites there, this message is to remind you where God has brought you from. For those of you who claim to be Christians today, where has God brought you from? He wants them to remember who they are and where they came from. It'd be for us to good to think back to those things in ourselves. We can easily share our testimony and say how God has delivered us. But has he indeed delivered us? Many of us have still, right where we were started, we attend church, we come in, we sit down, we sing, we praise, but we're still just where God found us. We have not moved a bit. To contemplate God's power in their lives. They're reminded about God's choices and call of Israel. How he redeemed them and delivered them from their Egypt. And all of us have some Egypts in our lives. God delivered us from our Egypts. How quickly, the further we get away from that Egypt, how quick we begin to, it grows dim in remembering where we come. But we need to remember from whence we came. We need to contemplate all the Lord has done for us. Remember where he found us. John 15:16 said, "You didn't choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask in his name." And he's given you grace and mercy every day. Contemplate God's presence in their lives. Israel is reminded that God has ever been with them. And everything that they faced, there was help. And there seemed to be, through everything that they went through, God was always there. And you ask yourself, God, are you with us now as we go through this terror of this COVID-19? I know this is it's being repeated over and over, but I assure you, since this terrible pandemic came upon us 6-7 months ago, every Sunday in the church, some preacher is talking about it, and he's relating it to what God's glory and grace has done for our lives. There's a message in this. You contemplate what the Lord has done for us. Contemplate God's presence in their lives. We contemplate God's presence in our lives. Today, we were saved by grace. God has never left us. Yes, we were saved by grace. Not by a political party. We were saved by grace. Not by the president. We were saved by grace. Not by anyone who says that I'm for you as long as you vote for me. We weren't saved by that. We were saved by grace. And believers need to get on their knees and pray today. Come together as a corporate group and pray for this nation. Pray for the church. Pray. We need to contemplate the fact that we have much this morning that we simply do not deserve. And think about it. We are saved, secure, headed to a home in heaven. Now, I say saved and secure and headed to a home in heaven. That's not for everyone because everyone's not headed. Everyone that calls themselves a Christian is not headed to heaven. I hope you do know that. All those who say that think that they believe and secure in God today, you probably need to go back and review that and say, Lord, just where am I with you? Still time to make up your mind. Every day that we wake up, it's another day that God gives us out of his grace and mercy to allow us to recover from those things in our lives that hinder us from having a perfect relationship with the Lord. We need to contemplate the fact that we have this morning, we have God's grace and mercy. We are indwelt by the Holy Spirit and live in this presence at all times. We live in the presence of the Holy Spirit. When the Holy Spirit is indwelling within us, when the enemy comes at us, when we read these things in the newspaper, when we watch CNN and all the other stations, a lot of Christians are intimidated by this and brought to fear. But God tells us we don't have to fear those things. That's one of the most powerful tools of the enemy, is to create fear in your heart and in your mind, make you doubt your faith. In light of these truths, I wonder why so many of God's children seem to have a hard time just simply loving and serving him as they should. A lot of Christians today have a very difficult time in loving and serving God. Folk don't attend church like they used to anymore. They have a number of reasons why not. But the moment something begins to happen that disturbs their way of life, such as this coronavirus, all of a sudden everyone starts looking to the Lord saying, why? Job, I believe, asked 13 times God why, and God gave him a little narrative as to why, who he is. He's a sovereign God, and where were you, Job? We ask these questions today. Lord says, look at what's going on. Christians seem to be absent in the places where they should be to defend the truth of God. Of course, this is nothing new. Israel was guilty of walking out on God, and many Christians today are guilty of walking out on God. He's been good. He was good to them. In Jeremiah 2:5-19 says, I wonder if you would not have to admit to the same kind of sin. Everything under the sun is allowed to come before the Lord in our lives. This simply is not right. Perhaps we need to contemplate what the Lord has done for us once again. Remember where he found you and all that he has done for you. It's so easy how we can forget where God, we can talk about it in a testimony. We can stand before folk and tell about our testimony, and people were in awe at that. But really, in our hearts, have we really left where we were when God found us? Are we just using that testimony to just present ourselves before people and grab a bit of ego, being a bit egotistical about who you are or where God has brought you? Be humble. Be humble. Because in an instant, you could be right back where you started from. Time of confrontation, verse 14 and 15 says that. That was the key verse. It says, now therefore fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity. What's missing in the world today in America is sincerity. They are not serving it from my interpretation, from my observation rather, is that there's a lack of sincerity in serving God. Only time that we become sincere is when something starts to happen in our lives. All of a sudden, God becomes number one. Verse 14, they were confronted by a command, and Joshua's command to the people was threefold. They were commanded to fear God, clean up their lives by putting away their other gods that they were to serve. And this would put them in a position to put God back in the forefront of their lives. Right now in America, we need to have God right back in the forefront of our lives. Not politicians. God needs to be there. Not someone who claims that they love the Lord and does quite the opposite. This command that God, people need to take heed today. We need to fear the Lord. That is, we need to reverence and honor him for who he is. He deserves to be respected and loved by those he has redeemed. And God has redeemed you through Christ Jesus. And the others have not. He's allowing them another day to confront the Lord and say, Lord, forgive me. I accept Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. Every day the sun rises, someone is given another opportunity to make up their minds. And some folks still have not made up their minds, even though they call themselves Christians. I heard a preacher say the other day that just because you call yourself a Christian doesn't mean that you have Christ in your heart. Because the devil sends folk to church too. And they sit right next to those who truly are believers. Fear the Lord. The word sincerity means wholeheartedly, completely with integrity. The word integrity. We talk about righteousness. We ask people, do you truly love the Lord? Are you bold in defending Christ when you're out and about amongst your friends and wherever you are? Or do you truly defend the truth of God's word with sincerity? The English word sincere comes from the Latin word, which means without wax. Now listen. It was used to refer to an unscrupulous pottery dealer who sold their first-class pottery that did not have cracks, that was patched with wax. When patched pottery was held up to the light, the wax was easy to spot. So as with people who live insincere lives, when they are held up to the light, their hypocrisy shows. The implication is for us that God does not want his people to live lives of hypocrisy. So if your life was like the pottery held up before the light of the world, will they see hypocrisy in you? Will you say that I am a true believer, but actually it looks good on the outside? Hello, it looks very nice. You look like a good Christian. But all the sin and all the things that brings about the vile and foul in you still exist because that crack in you, which is your insincerity as a believer, when it's held up to the light, it reveals your hypocrisy. And in America today, there's quite a lot of hypocrisy. A lot of believers are being held up to the light. All those folk who call themselves Christians, the evangelicals who, people who, and I could call it like a, stand up for the Lord. Don't just carry a name. Be a Christian. Forget all the other names. Evangelicals, Protestants, and all the others. When you're held up to the light, what are you really? What are you? Have you been covered in wax, trying to deceive a potential purchaser, someone to come up to purchase your pottery, or someone to come up to hear the word of God? You can't truly, sincerely defend the word of God when you have cracks. Jesus Christ cleans it. Time for those who have not made up their mind to make up their minds. Confronted by a challenge, confronted, the confrontation. Joshua set the example and laid down the gauntlet for the rest of the people by stating his clear intentions to serve God. You have to have clear intentions on serving God. You never know that day that you will not wake up. Have clear intentions today. You never know when someone in your life may not see the next day of life. Have clear intentions. Be able to defend the word of truth. I pray, when I pray and ask God for boldness to witness, to defend the truth. If you, Matthew 10:34-35, I believe, says, if you deny me before men on earth, I'll deny you before my Father who's in heaven. Be ready to stand and be sincere in defending the truth. Make up your mind today. Make up your mind. This virus right now is causing a lot of people to make up their mind. The loved ones in the hospital, once they are there, they never get an opportunity to see them again. And they wonder, Lord, why? my mother, my father, my sister, my brother, my niece, my nephew. I was unable to see them that one last moment. Why? Confronted by a challenge. We need some Joshuas in our today. We need a lot more Joshuas today to stand up and tell the people. Somehow those Joshuas are hiding behind the cloak of Christianity, waiting for a moment that makes them feel comfortable. I often say that you find those not so true, those insincere believers, they only believe the part of the Bible that makes them feel comfortable in their sin. But I got a word for you. Nowhere in the Bible that it makes you feel comfortable in your sin. That's the whole point of it. You feel comfortable by saying that some part of Scripture in the Bible makes you feel comfortable, you have a problem. The consecration. In 16, verse 16, so the people answered and said, "Far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods." And verse 17, "For the Lord our God, God is he who brought us out, our fathers, up and out of the land of Egypt, from the house of bondage, who did those great signs in our sight, preserved us in all the way that we went, and among all the people through whom we passed." God today preserves those of us today. He's preserving us throughout this pandemic today. We're being preserved. It's by the word of God, the power of God. We're being preserved for those who truly believe. We're being preserved. Don't have fear. You're being preserved. God is, whatever is going on, there's a reason for those things that's happening. The time of consecration, the resolve of the people. The people consider that all that the Lord has done for them, and they declare allegiance to him alone. They seem almost incredulous when offered the opportunity to serve other gods. No, the Lord said this morning, your choice this morning, if he has to compete for your time, has to compete for your attention, has to compete for your love, it calls your whole profession into question. What I mean by that is your profession. If God has to compete for your love, for your time, it calls into question your profession of faith. Do you really love the Lord? Consecration, a reminder to the people. Joshua takes the opportunity to remind them that God is holy and righteous, and if they serve him, he will bless them. But if they renege on the end of their agreement, they will also have a high price to pay. That message reverberates today. You say you love the Lord and you serve him. If you renege on that promise to him, then God has there's a consequence to your actions. God's people need to remember that God, while God is God of love, grace, and mercy, he is also still a holy and righteous God. He will not tolerate sin in the lives of his children. My friends, there's a terrible high price to pay for disobedience. In Hebrews 12 and 6th verse, because the Lord disciplines those he loves and punishes everyone except as a son. Sadly, many people pay the price for their sins in their children, their health, and in their homes. And you better understand today that you will reap exactly what you sow. Galatians 6:7. You will reap exactly what you sow. If you sow insincerity, then God is insincere towards you. If you sow lack of love towards God, then one thing about God is sort of unique. He loves us in spite of all the things that we do. He hates our ungodly sin, but he loves us. The reaction of the people. Now, how do we put this application of the confrontation, the consecration, and the contemplation, those things together that Joshua was telling the people? You enjoyed a life, and we brought you out of Egypt, and now you've enjoyed the God's grace and mercy. And now all of a sudden, you begin to forget who God is. And this crisis, this pandemic crisis, is reawakening the spirit of a lot of people to make them recognize just who God is. Well, that's good. Because otherwise, you've been on that headed for that waterfall to go off the cliff. Just a reminder. And how do we apply this to our lives? Read this verse again. Now therefore fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in truth, and put away the gods which your fathers served on the other side of the river and in Egypt. Serve the Lord. And if it seems evil to you, serve the Lord. Choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Make that choice. Make that choice as to whom you will serve. God keeps good records. He will hold us to the vows that we have made. In Ecclesiastes 5, 1 through 7, he wants us to serve him. When we choose to walk in a way that God does not please him, that does not please him, then we can. For those who have still not made up their mind. See, this crisis that we're going through right now is giving you many, but when I say you, I mean the whole world for that matter. But more specifically here, if there's someone here who's not made up their mind yet, today is time for you to make up your mind. If you're not, and then go ahead and serve whatever has your heart. If you haven't made up your mind, go ahead and keep serving what has your heart. But I guarantee you there's a consequence to it. Whatever you do, stop trying to have the best of both worlds. You can't either, you're going to be hot for God, and it's if you're lukewarm, he's going to spit you out. You make a choice. Either you serve the gods, as Joshua was saying to the Israelites, on the other side, or the gods in the world where you live today, or you're going to serve the God, the only God, the sovereign God. Christian that refuses to live for the Lord is a poor advertisement for the Lord Jesus Christ. Any Christian who refuses to live for the Lord is a poor advertisement. In other words, you don't represent Christ the way you should be if you're not living the life that God commands you to live. While a life lived in the power and victory is power indeed. Which are you? Perhaps you aren't where you are, but you want God to bless you where you are. You want to be able to overcome the difficulties that you're experiencing in life today, whatever they may be, physical ailment, emotional, financial, economical, whatever those things may be. If you want the Lord to really get your lives, choose today. Make up your mind today whom you will serve. There's still time. There's still time to make up your mind to the God that you're going to serve. Let us bow in prayer. Precious Father, we thank you for this moment in time. I pray that the word has extolled and exalted your name to the listeners and viewers, Heavenly Father, that they, if they have not made up their minds, it's still time to make up their minds to choose this day whom they will serve. They will choose the gods that where they were when God found them, or will choose the gods of this world that have no benefit to salvation, but they will live and stand and represent the only true God, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So, Father, we pray and pray for a blessing on each household, each member that's listening and viewing. Father, that your grace and mercy will continue to be upon them. For it is in Christ Jesus' name we pray, and we said amen. Give God a hug. Amen, amen, amen. We have the pastor. We have Pastor Watkins to come before and have some words.
Testing.
All
Hallelujah, hallelujah. We praise the Lord this morning. Let's just give the Lord a praise this morning. God is so worthy. Give him the glory. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus. We thank the Lord for Elder Byrd bringing a very powerful message, a reminder to make sure that we're in position to where we need to be. And I could just say that it's such a timely message for us to know that in the midst of all that's going on in the world, it's easy to become complacent and to even have a mindset that questions, well, where am I and what is God doing in my life? And so God lets us know that he is a very present help in the time of need. Amen. So we thank the Lord for you being here this morning, and we thank God once again for the word of God. At this time, we're going to go ahead with the communion. So I'm going to call Elder Byrd back so that he can share with us the communion. Amen. If you do not have the sacraments, please raise your hands. Deacon Holloway is coming around. He's going to make sure it's one all the way down to the end there, Sister Vera, I think. So let's make sure that everyone has that, and we'll move forward in just a moment. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. God bless each and every one. For those who are viewing live today, we just believe God to touch you in your homes. May God bless you. May God keep you until next Sunday. Amen. Be encouraged in the Lord and trust in the Lord with all of your heart and all of your mind and your soul. God is faithful to keep you. If you don't know Jesus, you can accept him by just saying, Lord, I believe in my heart that Jesus Christ died for me and for my sins. I ask that you forgive me, Lord, and I confess with my mouth and I believe with my heart that Jesus Christ is truly Lord and Savior. If you've done that, then God heard that prayer. It's not hard. It's not difficult. It's not lengthy. You just have to be real with God. He'll meet you exactly where you are. God bless you until next time. In Jesus' name, amen.